glory. Amen, amen. Before we start on announcements this morning, I want to recognize those with birthdays and anniversaries coming up. On the 7th, Harold Steele. On the 8th, Ursie Hill, Ross Coleman, amen. On the 9th, Georgiana Canada, Colin Hill. The 10th, Judy K. Knight, amen. 12th, Terry Jo Lee. 13th, Scott Graham, pretty good week. No anniversaries. No, if somebody needs to get married where we can fill that up next week. Any birthdays, anniversaries coming up, we didn't get called off. Sing birthday song then.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday.
Remind you, this month's newsletter is out. Brent's been taking care of that since Jan's been dealing with her health issues, and she's doing a whole lot better, and we appreciate that. The only bad thing about it is we had Robert here today without her, and that's a minus. So, but we appreciate what God's doing there. We've started doing men's prayer breakfast this month. Did you notice as soon as we opened up, the Texas opened up, they kind of knew we was ahead on stuff. We will do the third Sunday fellowship this month, beginning back this month. Also, on the third Sunday, now it's 2 weeks from today, Bill Rogers will be here. So put that on your calendar, invite your friends. And they're back on Channel 18's back on Dish. So you can tune them in on Sunday morning at 7 a.m. Next Sunday, time changes. No excuses. Don't want to hear anything. So be sure and set your clock and be here early. This month is our 28th year. We had our first service 28 years ago, McLean Cell Barn. And one of the neatest things, Wednesday night, Miss Ashley sang a special for it. Her grandmother sang the first special at Cowboy Church. And 28 years ago. She's got a tremendous voice. We'll let her share it with you next month on a Sunday. Got some other young people here we'll recognize. Allison Marshall, another one of our young ladies with tremendous singing ability. She's in a production at the Wichita Theater. It's called Matilda. And I think today is the last day, but it's at 2 o'clock. And she has a major role, so if you... Oh, it's not today? Bad intel. If you see this blonde running by, that's my...
Next Friday, next Saturday, two times on Saturday.
Okay, what time?
The first performance on Saturday is at
2,
and the second one, I believe, is at
7. Okay, so that's Friday and Saturday.
Friday and Saturday, and then Sunday, we're off
for
spring break.
Oh, okay, so, but she's not... They don't have one today. I mean, they don't have one today, though. Oh, okay, okay. So they do have one. Well, I apologize to my wife. They do, which I do constantly. There's nothing new.
That's why he's
so
got
we
it.
Do have a performance at 2 o'clock today, if you'd like to go to Wichita Theater. Then they'll have one next Friday and Saturday. Have one Friday and two Saturdays. So that she's tremendous talent. You'll enjoy that. If you're looking for some place to go, you'll really have a good time. We've got three young ladies here that can really sing, Ashley, Allison, and Delaney McDonald, and amen. And I've got with Carissa, and we're going to put together those three ladies, and Chris and them, a youth praise team, and about once a month, They're going to do praise and worship for us, and we're looking forward to that. Okay, Ashley Riddle won second with her heifer at Houston in the heifer class. And in the 2020 Fort Worth Calf Scramble Scholarship Program, she got $10,000 scholarship. Amen. Trent Tice, he got a $4,000 scholarship out of that same program, right, Trent? And then Hallie Hout got a $4,000 scholarship. So we're proud of our young people taking care of that. Offering, we don't take up an organized offering. Have a leather can church house at that foyer. Leather can on bookcase back here. How the Lord leads you in that direction. Miss Kathy has a special for us today. So without further ado, we'll do our congregationals, and Kathy will come and do a special, and we'll ask you to stand for praise and worship.
Victory ahead. When the see, let's go and see. When the host of Israel, led by God, round the walls of Jericho softly trod, trusting in the Lord, they felt the conqueror's strength. By faith they saw the victory ahead, victory ahead, victory ahead, through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead, trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread. By faith I saw the victory ahead. David with the shepherd's sling and five stones, led the giant on the hill all alone. Trusting in the Lord, he knew what God had said. By faith he saw the victory ahead, victory ahead, victory ahead, through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead, trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread, by faith I see the victory ahead. Daniel prayed unto the Lord Christ each day, then unto the lion's den led the way, trusting in the Lord, he knew what God ordained. By faith he saw the victory ahead, victory ahead, victory ahead, through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead, trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread. By faith I see the victory ahead. Often with a carnal mind I was tried, asking for deliverance of my pride. Trusting in the Lord, I reckon I was dead. By faith I saw the victory ahead. Victory ahead, victory ahead, through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead. Trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread. By faith I see the victory, glory ahead. When like others have gone before to that land, by death's river cold and dark I shall stand. Trusting in the Lord, I will not fear or dread. By faith I see the victory ahead. Victory ahead, victory ahead, through the blood of Jesus, victory ahead, trusting in the Lord, I hear the conqueror's tread. By faith I see the victory. victory ahead.
When we all get to heaven.
Amen.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven.
Good morning. Now you can hear me. What? Of course. One of the jobs as a Christian, I believe, and everybody in here knows this, so I'm just going to repeat what you already know. But we are to edify the body of Christ. We are to be the body of Christ and encourage each other. So this is a song that will encourage you. I know you've most of you have heard this song. I've never sung it before, and that's why I'm shaking like a leaf. It has some notes in it that are, I'm going to have to pull the top of my roots and my hair to get up there. But if I see anybody doing this, I know I didn't hit it right. Okay, so this is to edify you. This is to go and spread the news that one day we will see Jesus face to face. The sky will unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. Change in
Please stand for praise and worship.
Worship you forever in your
soul sings. Here in your presence, here on your wings.
Love you so much, Jesus. Love you so much. Love you so much, Jesus. Love you so much.
Father God, we just come before you right now to say thank you. Thank you for the privilege of being in your house to worship you today with brothers and sisters, Father God. Father, we just come before you right now and ask you to heal us spiritually, Father God, so that we can be the children, the daughters, and the sons that you've called us to be, and we can go out and reach a nation, Father God, that needs spiritual healing, Father. Thank you for loving us just as we are. Thank you that we can come as we are. We lift our pastor up to you right now. We ask you, Father God, to use him as a vessel that you prepared him to be, to bring the message to each heart in this building. Holy Spirit, fill this place up. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Children can be dismissed for children's church, 3 through 9. Intermediate class can also be dismissed at this time. Kathy, that was beautiful, girl. It was pretty beautiful. Rest, if you would, turn to 1 Samuel 17 and Mark 9, 2 Corinthians 10. 1 Samuel 17, Mark 9, 2 Corinthians 10. And we want to take this time to welcome our Facebook congregation. Glad to have you this morning. Beginning with 1 Samuel 17, verses 26 and 32, David talked to some others standing there to verify the report. What will a man get for killing this Philistine and ending his insults to Israel? He asked them. Who is this heathen Philistine anyway that he is allowed to defy the armies of the living God? Verse 32, don't worry about a thing, David told him. I'll take care of this Philistine. Mark 9:23, and this is the Living Bible. If I can, Jesus asked, anything is possible if you have faith. King James, Jesus said unto him, if you can believe, how many things? All things are possible to him that believes. 2 Corinthians 10:5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Amen. We're going to put a couple supportive verses up there, and you can write those down when you get home, look them up and read them, and I think they'll bless you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I ask your blessings upon this service. I ask for the anointing as I minister your word today. Give me the words, the thoughts, and the ideals that you want shared with your people. And Father, just let them receive them with an open mind and an open heart. Father, not only that, but to apply them. Father, to apply them to their life. And Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Excuse me. The title of today's message is The Power of a Positive Attitude. The Power of a Positive Attitude. I see so many people, children of God, that are living defeated lives, not experiencing the good things God their Father wants them to have, the things He desires. And why? Because of bad attitudes. Another word for it, for stinking thinking. Do you know, excuse me, do you know people who are always negative in their attitudes, in their speech, and in their thoughts? Now, men, look at me. And you know, those people always look or only see the bad in situations, and nothing satisfies them. I mean, they're those kind of people, if it's 73 degrees, all they can talk about how hot it is. The next day, if it's 71, all they can talk about is how cold it is. If it happens to be 72, all they can do is talk about what it should be this way all the time, but it won't be this way tomorrow. Do you know people like that? Let me ask you this. How about you? Are you a pessimist or an optimist? Are you a pessimist or an optimist? You know, I know people that worry because things are going good. Well, something's going to happen. When it's this good, something's bound to happen. And they have a pessimistic attitude. You know, my mother and I really appreciate some of the lessons that she taught us when we were children. But one of the lessons, my mother was real poor growing up. They worked in a cotton patch and truck farms and so forth. And as young people, we were like anybody else. We'd go talk about, well, so-and-so's got this new thing. So-and-so's got this. So-and-so's got these kind of clothes. And then she'd say, you know what? You just look what you got compared to somebody else that has less than you. And then all of a sudden, what we did have, we appreciated it more. And it meant a lot. Growing up, my wardrobe come from the garage sales here in Henrietta. They used to have a citywide garage sale. But we were a lot better off than a lot of the other people at that time. My granddaughter, McKinley, takes PT twice a week at the rehab. She's working her shoulder back, and everything's going real well, and it's doing good. It's been a long, trying experience. It seems like you take one step back, forward, two back, or so forth, but we're right there today. In fact, she ended her throwing program the other day. She played in her first varsity softball game yesterday, so we're proud for that. But now the story is this. I go out there and I take her in, and I sit out on the parking lot for about an hour while they're working with her. And every time there's this lady pulls up, and she has these two little boys. They're about this tall. And one of them he's just full of vim and vigor. I mean, she lets him out of the car, and he's running here and there. Well, the other one's the one they're working with, and he has special needs, and she has to take his wheelchair out. He has a motorized wheelchair. She goes, takes it out, sets it up, and then she has to go get him out of the car seat and put him in the wheelchair. Man, he just got that wheelchair not long ago. Now, I'm telling you, he just like a little buzz. You can just tell this kid it's a big deal. Imagine what it'd be like for you to have someone to always carry you to go somewhere, and all of a sudden you've got the means that you can go yourself, the thrill of that. And the other day, Terry went with us, and she went in with Kenley, and him and his other brother were in there racing one another. He was racing his brother on his wheelchair. Well, last night, and I didn't have a clue who it was, but I'll tell you this, I'd see that woman, and I'd look at her. She always has a pleasant smile on her face, has a lot of patience with those boys, and I get thinking what it must be like to deal with that day in and day out. And not to keep from getting a negative attitude, but she just has such a spirit, you can tell, a loving spirit. But I look at that and I think, you know what? What my granddaughter's going through is nothing compared to that. Doesn't amount to anything. And a lot of times we get so bound down in what we don't have that we forget the benefits we do have. And if we go to comparing what other people are dealing with, we've got it made in the shade. But I'm going to tell you how God works. I prepared this message on Thursday morning, wrote this down on Thursday morning. Last night, I'm sitting there watching the news, and I don't stay up to watch the news late. You know, I'm during 9 o'clock, I'm out of there. I shut my cell phone off. You're not getting me. It'll wait till in the morning, and I'm out of there. But I was watching that last night. Kenny had got a real good hit in the ball game. It looked, the TV were people there. I thought maybe they were going to have it on the deal. Well, it just so happens on the news, they have a story about this little boy. They have fundraisers, and they're saying for $200,000 he can go to Florida and have an operation where this little boy can walk. And his name is Logan Fox. Now, you tell me, I don't believe in coincidences. I believe in the hand of God. God knew I was going to use him this morning, and he gave me his name and what they're going through. Have you ever had something happen that you thought was the worst thing that could possibly happen, but it turned out to be the best? Maybe you lost a job and you thought that's just the end of it. But before it's all over with, you got a job. There's a better job, better benefits, less hours. Or maybe we'll just take a horse. Maybe if you ever had a horse to die or something, you just thought it was the end of the world. But then it wasn't too long, you got a better horse that was a whole lot better than that one. Or maybe you were in a relationship and the person jilted you, walked away, or maybe even a divorce. And you just thought the bottom had fallen out of everything. It would never be any good again. But before it's all over with, you met a new person, and you were happier beyond measure. You know, your attitude and your thinking, more than anything else, determines God's ability to give you your desires and to meet your needs. Ronnie Christian is a cowboy preacher, a PRCA bareback rider, and he's written a book that says Hang On to Your Hope. And in that, he tells one of his stories, and it's about when his son was 8 days old, and he was in intensive care unit in the hospital, and he quit breathing. He turned purple. And the doctors, they did CPR on him for 20 minutes. Finally, they come out, and they told Ronnie what had happened. And they told him, here's what's going to happen as a result of that. He's going to have brain damage, and he's going to be a vegetable. Ronnie, instead of becoming negative, he just reached over. He took that doctor by the hand, and he prayed a prayer that he had never prayed before. He said, Father, when your son Jesus went to the cross, he took care of every need and we've ever needed, and I thank you for my son's healing. Within the hour, his lungs finally opened, and today he's a healthy, alert man. Why? Now, what if he, amen. What if he had become negative? Oh, it's all over with. You know, there ain't nothing we can do. You know what? Nah. He had a positive attitude, and he stood on the Word of God. You know, some here today are dealing with health problems. Don't seem like it's going to ever get any better, going to change. Maybe you have financial needs. You don't ever see it getting any better. All you can see is a red in your checkbook. Maybe you're here today, you or your loved ones, and you're dealing with drug problems. You just don't see how you're going to ever be able to get off or get them off. You have children that are living out in the world, ungodly lifestyles. Maybe you're here today or you're watching on Facebook and your marriage is in trouble. Or maybe you're dealing with loneliness and depression. You feel trapped. You have no hope. And you've allowed a negative, hopeless attitude to begin to take hold of you. And it's literally squeezing the life out of you. What you need to do is to start quoting Mark 9:23. All, not some, but all things are possible to those who believe. Not to those who worry, not to those who beg. Not to those who pray or bargain, but to those that believe. So God's telling you right there, there's nothing you're dealing with that there's not a possibility it can't change or be taken care of. And as a result of that, you need to get an I can do attitude, that I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. And you need to get your eyes on God and on His Word. See, in 1 John 1, it says, Jesus and the Word are the same. So it says, through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. You can also make it say like this, through the Word that strengthens me. And get your eyes on that. Get your eyes off the floor and on your God and His ability. If you're a born-again believer, begin to realize you're a child of God. And all the riches of heaven are at your disposal. God's, what kind of father withholds things from his kid? What kind of earthly father will withhold things from his kid that they needed? 2 Peter 1:3 says, once again, there's that word all. And I studied that real deep one time, looked it up. And you know what it meant? The Greek? All. All things that pertain unto life. God's given you everything. When I open my Bible every morning, I look and I say, God, in these pages are everything I need to live an overcoming and a victorious life, to meet every need I have. Help me to understand it, to remember it, but most of all, to apply it to my life. And that's what God's Word is. What you need to do is, as a child of God, you need to begin to act like it. You need to begin to talk like it. And you need to have the attitude, I can't go under because I'm going to go over. And you need to confess victory. I don't care. Just like Ronnie Christian, I don't care how hopeless it looks, you confess victory. When God is on your side, all the demons in hell can't defeat you. Do you understand that? When God's on your side and he's battling for you, I don't care what Satan throws at you. He can't beat God. The problem is this. Many Christians need an attitude adjustment. Have you ever heard somebody say, well, they need an attitude adjustment? And most Christians within the church need an attitude adjustment and get off this old woe is me, poor is me attitude and begin to realize what Jesus Christ did on the cross and what is available to them. You know, I see so many people who have a winning attitude until trouble comes, until they face disappointments. I've had over the years many people come to this church, and I mean they get all excited about Mark 11, 23, 24. I mean they just love the faith message. And before too long, boy, I'm God's man or woman of faith. Well, I could move a mountain. And the word, they just say the word of God means what it says. I believe what it says, and I'm going to stand on it through thick and thin. And I've seen so many of those people that the first time trouble comes, the first time they experience a setback, they cut and run. They have a major meltdown, and you don't see a lot of them for anymore. They're about like the university student. And they had to take this science test in order to stay in college. I mean, it was all on the line. And this boy, he studies for this test for a week, a solid, day and night. Day of the test, he walks into class. I mean, he's full of confidence. He knows this book forwards or backwards. He has a winning attitude. When he walks into the class, across the front of the class, there were 10 birds on pedestals. And every one of them had a sack over its body with only its legs showing. The professor said, I want you to name and classify each one of these birds by their legs only. That young man had no clue. And his winning attitude went out the window. He stands up and he said, this is a stupid test. This is a stupid university. And you're a stupid professor. The professor says, what's your name, boy? The boy reaches down, he pulls up his past leg, said, you tell me, professor, you tell me. You know, many of us lose our attitude of faith when we can't see any results from what we're believing God for. We don't want to walk. Do you know people don't want to walk by faith? You know what? I'll be right up front with you. I don't like the walk of faith. It's against my nature in my body. We want to walk by sight and senses, what circumstances tell us. And the Bible has a word for that. It's called Thomas. And when you're walking by your senses and what you can see or feel, then you're nothing but a doubting Thomas. And we're not going to believe till we see it. God's word, the Bible says, you're not going to see it till you believe it. You're not going to see it till you believe it. We need to develop a childlike faith, and we don't have to understand everything that happens. Just believe God's going to take care of it. He's going to handle it. He's going to provide for you. He's going to take you through these storms. You know, we just need to be like little children. There's a dad walked in one day, and his little four-year-old boy, he was there at the table. Boy, he had a piece of paper and some crayons, and he was just going around that, and the guy says, son, what are you doing? What are you drawing? And the little boy says, I'm drawing a picture of God. And the man said, but son, no one knows what God looks like. And the boy says, they will when I get through. That's the attitude we need to have. How many times do you hear yourself say, I'm afraid, I feel, I doubt, I can't, I'm worried, I hope? When you're uttering those words, then you're walking in the flesh. You're walking what you can see in the natural realm. The word says this. It says, fear not, fear not. And I understand it's in the Bible 365 times. Why? It's because God wants to remind you every day, fear not. I don't care what you're battling. I don't care what you're dealing with. I don't care what your problem is. You know what God's answer is? Fear not. Just keep your old focus on me. God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. So when you're afraid of something, do you know who's under control you're under? You're under Satan's control. It says God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of sound mind. What you want to do is quit allowing those thoughts to take root in your mind. But you want to fill your mind with thoughts of faith. 2 Corinthians 10:5, we just read, it says, bring every thought into captivity to the Word of God. Make every thought you have line up with what the Word of God says. If you're battling illness, you want to make it line up with the Word of God. It says, by His stripes you're healed. Jesus bore your infirmities. You need to begin to think what God's Word says about your situation. God says, I delight in the prosperity of my servants. God says, I give you the desires of your heart. Begin to believe that you're in the presence of God, that His power is in you, which is the Holy Spirit. And then you can say this, greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. Instead of saying, I'm afraid, begin to confess, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. Whatever you're battling, whatever you're dealing with, you just need to begin to utter those words. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. Begin to see, get a vision of yourself as a winner. If you're battling illness, you get you a picture of the best thing in the world when you were at your prime, and some of us, it'll be a long time ago. I'm going to tell you this. I kind of got a problem with all these cameras, you know, on the phones and stuff. When those get wiped out, you don't have any pictures. There will come a day when you don't have, at a funeral, you don't have a picture deal like we do now because there's no pictures, you know. So get you a black and white, if you're young especially, or colored, of you in your prime. And if you're ever having to deal with healing or something, put that up on the refrigerator, up on the TV or whatever, and get that vision in your mind. Begin to get a vision of yourself being delivered from whatever you're battling, for overcoming whatever's come against you. Get a vision of yourself being prosperous. And do that not when it happens, but before. Begin to see and say those things. Fill your mouth and your mind with thoughts of faith and courage. The smartest thing you can do is get you index cards. And what you want to do, I would do, is get me an index card. And on that card, I'd put, I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. Daniel 11:32, the people that know their God shall be strong and do exploits. I'd have Matthew 17:20, if you have faith, nothing shall be impossible. I'd have Peter 1:5-7, cast all your care upon the Lord, for He cares for you. I'd have on this one index card. You can put it in your pocket, put it in your purse. And I come across the scripture the other day, just blessed me beyond measure. And it's Psalms 112, verses 6 and 7 in the Living Bible. Such a man will not be overthrown by evil circumstances. God's constant care of him will make a deep impression of all who see it. Verse 7 says, he does not fear bad news, nor lives in dread of what may happen, for he is settled in his mind that Jehovah will take care of him. Are you settled in your mind that God will take care of whatever you're dealing with? Then if you're not, Satan's going to eat your lunch. You need to settle it in your mind. Begin to build your faith. Feed your spirit man daily with faith scriptures and faith stories. I've told you before, the worst thing you can do is sit around and watch them old soap operas, watch them old pictures where somebody dies, battles, and, you know, quit watching The View, quit watching all that junk, because that's what's in your mind. And your mind is nothing but a computer. What you put in it is what comes out. And if you put that trash in your mind, when those circumstances come, you're immediately going to think of what you saw and watched. But fill your mouth and mind with faith word, faith scriptures, and faith stories. Certain foods produce certain effects. And those, Your body has to have food every day, your physical body. Now, some of us could go a few days without it, but most people. Your spirit man's the same way. You have to feed him in order for him to grow and to be strong. And you feed him with the Word of God. You need to see how others in the Bible who battle circumstances and they refuse to become negative. Stories like Abraham who went 12 years believing God for a son. I can't even get people to believe God for 12 hours. For 12 years he refused to give up. Called it done. Every time he answered Abraham or told somebody his name, he was telling them what God had said. He became a father. Joseph, who went from a pit to slavery to prison, but yet he refused to become negative, and he wound up prime minister. David, who experienced the wilderness to run away from his family and his friends, but yet he refused to become negative, and he wound up the king. God put those stories in his word to encourage you and to give you faith as you battle the storms of life. You know, I will give you a couple of examples of winning attitude, and they're well known. Goliath, the giant. Now, how many of you understand that's a big problem? I mean, that's a major problem. Well, let me ask you this. How big is your problem, what you're dealing with? Is it any bigger than Goliath? I don't think so. David and Israel saw the same circumstance. They both saw the same giant, and he wasn't bigger for one of them than he was the other. He was 9 foot tall or bigger, same size for both of them. But yet they had different attitudes. Israel had a loser's attitude, and they were gripped in fear, despair, with no way out. David had a winning attitude. He looked at that giant as an opportunity. You know, you need to look sometimes at what you're dealing with as an opportunity for your God to show you how big he is and what he can do. He says, what do I get when I kill him? Let me tell you what, when you're facing a giant and you use your faith to overcome it, then boy, that just increases your faith to receive more from God. What was the difference in their attitude? Why the difference? David was looking at how big his God was, and Israel was looking at how big the giant was. There's no difference in what you're dealing with today. Are you focused on your problem? You focused on your God. One of them is a winner's attitude. The other is a loser's attitude. Second example was the 12 spies that went in and looked at the promised land. All 12 of those saw the same thing. I mean, they acknowledged it's a good, fertile land. And I love this part. They even brought back the proof. Took 2 men to carry a cluster of grapes. And people, that's a big grape. Those grapes had to be about the size of a cantaloupe or something. But they're carrying this grape on their shoulder. How many of you know that with God's blessings, with God's promises, there's going to come giants? Any time that you try to stand on God's promises and his blessing, you can rest assured the giants are going to show up. Now, 10 of those 12 has a loser's attitude. Their attitude was this: we can't whip the giant, even though God has told them they could. Here's what happened. It says in Psalm 78, they turned back and limited the Holy One of Israel. When you're walking in fear, doubt, and despair, you've limited the Holy One of Israel. You said, God, you can't handle this. It's too big a problem for you. You can't take care of it. And as a result of that attitude, their doubt and unbelief, they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years till they die. And I promise you this, if you've got that attitude, all you're going to do is wander in the wilderness to finally you die off. On the other hand, there was 2 of that 12, Joshua and Caleb. And they had a positive attitude. They said, oh, man, we can do it. God will give us the victory. He said we could have it. We could do it. Why the difference? They believed God's word that he meant what he said. Now, here's the question today. When faced with a giant or difficulties, Do you believe your word or do you believe your eyes? You have a choice. You have a choice. Your attitude can literally cause you to miss a big blessing, a tremendous blessing. There was two men that were jilted. Their girlfriends left them. One of them's attitude was this. He went and jumped off a bridge and took his life. The other sat down and he wrote a She Done Me Wrong song and made $50,000 on it. For $50,000, you can forget anybody. Amen. You know what the Bible tells you this, teaches this? If life hands you a lemon, you take your faith, your God, his ability, and you make lemonade. I could sit down many times over my life, things I thought just the bottom for it all over, it turned out the best thing ever happened to me. Peter got his eyes on Jesus instead of the storm, and he walked on water. He walked across the top of his problem. And you can do the same today. If you'll focus on the word, if you'll focus on Jesus, you can walk across your problem. Get your eyes off your problem, your need, your situation, and on Jesus. Sadly, there's not a lot of Davids, Joshua, Calebs. There's not a lot of water walkers in the Christian community. Sadly, most of them are like those that sat in the boat. They're boat potatoes. And I still, to this day, I can't help believe that when Peter, they sat there and they encouraged Peter to step out on the water, and probably all of them sitting there, that sucker's going to sink like a lead balloon, you know. But they weren't going to get out of that boat. And I'll tell you this, you'll never walk across your problems, your storms, till you get out of the boat and begin to focus on Jesus and walk on the water. You've also got to understand this. Your attitude can literally kill you. Doctors are smart enough of this. They won't operate anybody that thinks they're not going to make it. They know that for a fact. True story. Major Harold Kushner was an Army medical doctor, and he was held by the Viet Cong for 5 years, and he shares about what happened at the Loss of Hope. Among the POW in Kushner's camp was a tough young Marine, 24 years old. This Marine had survived 2 years of POW in relatively good health. The reason for the endurance, the camp commander had promised to release him if he cooperated. And since this had been done to the others, the Marine turned into a model POW and become a leader of the camp's thought reform group. However, as time passed, the young Marine realized that he was being lied to by his captors. Once that realization took hold, he became a zombie. He refused to work. He rejected all offers of food and encouragement. He simply laid down on his cot in a fetal position, sucking his thumb, and in a matter of weeks, he was dead. He was caught in the vice grip of lost hope. And once he had surrendered to despair, there was nothing left but to lie down and die. Saints, have you given up hope today on something you wanted from God? You're no different than this Marine. What you've got to do is dust yourself off, get right back up, and begin to confess that whatever you're hoping for and believing for, it's going to take place. God doesn't say a few things are possible, some, but all things are possible to those that have faith. How do you build a winning attitude? At least 10 times a day, repeat Romans 8:31. If God be for me, who can be against me? I'm more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. This is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad. That should be the first thing out of your mouth when your feet hit the floor in the morning. I mean, this is God has given you a day, and you're going to rejoice, and you're going to be glad in it, because ain't nothing coming out to you that day God can't take care of. And then 10 times a day, repeat Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. God hasn't given me a spirit of fear, but a power and a sound mind. Repeat those at least 10 times every day. Then you need, here's a list of things to do to overcome bad attitudes and stinking thinking. Always picture success no matter how bad things seem at the time. And I'm telling you, in the days ahead, you're going to see some bad times. And I'm not being negative. I'm just telling you what you look at. especially the oil field, what all's happened in it. But you know what? God's bigger than the oil field. He's much bigger than Joe Biden. So it doesn't matter there. Always picture success no matter how bad things seem to be at the time. The Bible says, without a vision, the people perish. You need to get a vision of victory. Emerson says this, they conquer who believe they can. Whenever a thought of fear comes in your mind, speak out loud a thought of faith. Fear knocked, faith answered, no one was there. Emerson says this, do the thing you fear, and the death of fear is certain. You need to practice confidence and faith, and your fears and insecurities will soon have no power over you. Put yourself in God's hands and begin to say, I'm in the hands of God. Then believe you're now receiving the power you need, and you need to allow God's Spirit to fill you. Begin to be positive. Begin to be positive in your speech, in your thoughts, and in your actions. And remember this, the power of a positive attitude. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand. Those at Facebook, you can join with us this morning. But I want to minister healing to you this morning, especially if you're here today, everybody's head bowed and eyes closed. But if you're here today and you need healing for your body, I just want you to place your hands upon your body, upon your chest. Amen, amen. The Word of God says that Jesus bore that infirmity on His body. And by His stripes you're healed. Body, be unto you according to the Word of God. Body, be whole in Jesus' name. And all God's people in faith said, give the Lord a hand clap this morning. Do that every day. Thank God for your healing. And it'll manifest itself. You know, I told you earlier, and I don't know if we've ever done this before, but I don't think it was a coincidence that that little boy was on the news last night. But I've got a can right here, and we're going to take up a love offering for him. So, and I'm going to tell you this. You don't know. You could give a love offering because your kids are healthy and your grandkids are healthy. Whatever take up, we'll make sure they get it. If you're watching on Facebook and you want to help be a part of it, just email a check in, just stub it, Logan Fox, and we'll make sure they get it. So we're going to leave this can up here and have the Lord lead you in that direction. We appreciate you being here today. Don't remember, next Sunday, daylight savings time. You got to be here an hour earlier. And then 2 weeks from today, Bill and Roger's going to be here. So be sure and bring friends to see that. We appreciate each one of you today. God bless you. Meditate on what we shared this morning. Check yourself. Ask your spouse or your friend, am I being positive about things or am I being negative? Do you get up in the morning and say, oh, Lord, it's morning? Or do you get up and say, thank you, God, it's morning. I'm going to have a wonderful day. You can start your day with a positive attitude or you can just drag your chin on the floor. The choice is yours. Steve Nash, would you dismiss us with a word of prayer?